It's a great joy for me to come back to Bethany, and I want to say thank you for allowing us to worship Christ along with you all, and do want to express my gratitude and thankfulness to Pastor Scott, Mike, and the elders board here for partnering with us in the work that God has entrusted to us there in India. And we are also grateful, as Benedict said, we are grateful to the Bethany Boys Home that you support for many years now. And we will be grateful that if you would continue to pray for them, pray that they will continue to grow in the fear and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I will also appreciate your prayers as we look forward to having the Bethany team with us very soon. I think it is just a few more weeks left. They will be coming there in Jan. And as a church, I'll be grateful if you would pray for them and support them and send them out to India with your blessing. As you all know, for the passage for today's meditation is taken from Mark chapter 16 and verses 14 to 20. I know we read the passage, but I would like to just read it once again so that you will get to hear God's word from where we are going to meditate upon. Mark chapter 16, verses 14 to 20. Later, Jesus appeared to the 11 as they were eating. He rebuked them for their lack of faith and their stubborn refusal to believe those who had seen him after he had risen. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well." After the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was taken up into heaven, and he sat at the right hand of God. Then the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied them. Now, this passage, as you all know, is after the Lord was resurrected, and you all know that the disciples were struggling with the issue of disbelief. And the passage what we just read is when Jesus appears to them after his resurrection. And we are looking at the passage in the first place, when Jesus appears to them and rebukes them for their unbelief. Now, Judas being gone, the 11 apostles had gathered together. Actually, there were not 11. In fact, only 10 of them were there, because when Jesus appeared, Thomas was not with them. But because their whole company consisted of 11 disciples, the group is referred to in the passage that we read as 11 disciples. And when Christ appeared to them, the scripture says he rebukes them for their unbelief and the hardness of heart. And as you all know, after the death of Jesus Christ, their hearts were much affected, and they were filled with sorrow, and they were going through this trouble of loss of Christ. And when they had come together, there was much fear, and they had led to, and there was so much fear and unbelief, and that had led them to not believe that Jesus had risen from death. Fear of what will happen to them next. Fear of the future. Where will we be? The Lord is not there with us anymore. What will happen to us? What will happen to our future? And as you know, the fear had gripped their heart. In the midst of fear, when they were afraid, when they were fearful, they forgot what Christ had told them about resurrection. They forgot the promises of Christ. They forgot that they serve a God who is all-powerful and almighty. Their focus was so much on the immediate situation. Their focus was so much on the circumstances that they were going through, and not on the promises of God. And this is very true even today. Sometimes we go through the same. The immediate circumstances, the immediate situations that we go through, this grips our heart, And there is fear. And fear comes and takes over our life. And in the midst of that fear, we forget who our Lord Jesus Christ is. We forget his promises. We forget to believe we serve an almighty God. I know we are all humans, but when this fear takes over, we forget that we serve an almighty and all-powerful God. Our situation and our circumstances does not change our God. I hope we remember that. All of us go through in our lives situations, circumstances that are not favorable, that are not very happy. And we need to remember when we go through those situations, God does not change, nor does it change the ability of our God to intervene into those situations. That is exactly what the disciples were going through. They were caught up in the circumstances and the situations in which they were. They entirely forgot what Christ had told them, the promises of God, and what God is able to do in and through their lives. Mary Magdalene and the other disciple who were eyewitnesses that he was risen from the dead had shared with them what they had seen. None of this made an impression of them upon them. Maybe they thought, if indeed he is risen, he should do the honor of showing himself first to us because we are the chosen disciples. And if he had gone past them, if he had gone past by and has shown himself to others first, then they could not believe that it was him, that it was Jesus who was risen. Nor could they believe that he is resurrected from death as promised, as said by him. Though they had not still seen him, they were justly blamed because they believed not them who had seen him after he was risen. And it is true even today. There are many who refuse to believe him because they say that they have not seen him physically. They refuse to believe and put their faith in him. They refuse to accept the truth that the scripture tells us to accept. We all go through that. Many of the non-Christians go through that. You know, we have a lot of non-Christian students who come into our skills training program. In fact, every year we train about 1,250 Hindu and Muslim ladies in our skills training program. And they come to us and say, if you really want us to believe in your God, we want him to do a miracle. We want him to show up. And sometimes the Lord does that. You know, interestingly, I think last time when I was here, sometimes I question God. Here I am, a Christian for 35 years. I am in the mission work. And when I pray, I don't see sometimes physical miracles. Here is an unbeliever. Somebody who has just come to know Christ, and he cries out, and the Christ shows up and does a miracle. And I say to God, why not to me, Lord? And he says, Saji, grow up. Just grow up. You have seen enough to believe me. And then today there are many Christians, even in the church, they say, I don't believe unless I see him. For those of us who have seen him, who have experienced him, he expects us to believe him and to trust him. And trust him, not demanding a miracle, because we know he is a faithful God. We know he is a promise-keeping God. We don't need to test God one after the other situations. You know, many Christians today, maybe not in Bethany Church, but in other churches I have seen, many Christians today, so-called Christians, they insist on Jesus appearing to them in a dream or a vision. Then will they trust in him? They want to see a physical miracle. They want to put the Lord to the test every time they face a situation. And the Lord says to many of us, we need to grow up. My friends, I want to tell you, faith demands much more than that. Faith is to believe what we have not seen and believe in the one whom we have not seen. You know, after rebuking them for their disbelief and hardness of heart, Christ gives them a commission. Christ, it's very interesting. This morning I was sitting and reading there. I will come to that in a little while. There was no time for self-pity. There was, yes, the disciples were afraid. They were going through a hard time. But Christ rebukes them, and then immediately he gives them a commission. His commission for them was to set up his kingdom among men by the preaching of his gospel, the glad tidings of reconciliation to God through the mediator. The fear or immediate circumstances didn't stop Christ from commissioning them. They had a job to be done, and they must get on with it even in the midst of unbearable circumstances or circumstances that were not favorable to them. The excuse of fear, the excuse of persecution, the excuse of circumstances and situations that we go through, the excuse of situation not being favorable were not good enough. Disciples must get on with their job of taking the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. You know, so far they had been sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and were forbidden to go to the Gentiles or into the city of Samaritans. But now their commission is enlarged, and they are authorized to go into all the world, into the parts of the world, and to preach the gospel of Christ to every creature, to the Gentiles as well as to the Jews, to every human creature. Inform them concerning Christ, the history of his life, the death and the resurrection, and to instruct them the opportunity that the children of men have, and to invite them to come and to share in this redemptive work. The good news is that it is not just for the Jews, but for all mankind, and nobody is excluded from that. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Let this be preached in all places, to all the persons, to the uttermost parts of the world. You know, Christ gives them this commission, and he expects each one of them to go into the world and travel to every part. Everyone had their area or that part of the world marked out for them, and they are to fulfill their ministry. And the interesting thing is, these 11 men could not do this on their own, or cannot do on their own. They needed much more people to join that commission. That this needs to go to every creature. So, but they had the other disciples. Later on, the 70 joined with those who would afterward will add to them and will disperse to the ends of the world and preach the gospel. And besides, this commission not only included the apostles and the first century Christians, but to all the Christians in the succeeding ages and to the ends of the world. You know, and since that commission, there are parts of the world which was not known is now discovered. And this order includes those parts as well as what was not known during those days. As other areas came known to the humankind, we are commanded to go and preach the gospel even to those areas. And they must send others to those places where they could not go themselves. And in short, make it a business of their life to send those glad tidings up and down the world. Not as an amusement, not as an entertainment. Today many people do that. They use the gospel as an amusement or an entertainment, but as a solemn message from God to man, and an appointed means of making men happy. Tell as many as you can and encourage them to tell others. It's a message of universal concern, and it is meant for the whole universe. So, after resurrection, Christ appears to them, rebukes them of their disbelief and fear. And in other words, what he does is, he is rebuking them of their inaction, and then gives them a commission of taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. And the summary of this gospel, or the message that they are to preach, is about life and death. What is this message? This message is all about life and death. A choice that every mankind has to make between life and death, between good and evil. Tell the children of man that they are all in a state of misery and danger, condemned by their friends and conquered and enslaved by the evil one. But if they believe the gospel, and if they give themselves to the Christ disciples, if they renounce the devil, the world, and the flesh, and be devoted to Christ as their priest and as their king, and by their willingness to follow him, they shall be saved from the guilt and the power of sin. It shall not rule them. It shall not ruin them. It was this gospel that he wanted them to preach to the world. The word of peace and reconciliation, which was brought to us by his atoning sacrifice. The message of free and full pardon of his blood, and of the justification by his righteousness, and of the complete salvation by him. If they believe this message, there is redemption and salvation. If they believe not, if they receive not the message, they cannot expect any other way of salvation, but must inevitably perish. Do you realize what a precious message you have? It's a message of life and death. And I hope this message, what we have, we do not take this lightly. Because you have a message which can bring life and death to the human mankind. The one that believes and is baptized shall be saved. The one that does not believe shall be condemned. Jesus is not telling us to be saved by works. Baptism is not your good work. You can take no credit for it. But also faith is not your work either. You don't say, I am so good because I believe. Faith says, Jesus is my righteousness. Jesus is my Savior. You know, baptism and faith, God gives them both to you. They are not the things that you give to God. If you think that baptism and faith are your gift to God, then you have missed the point. Baptism and faith are God's gift to you. When you put your trust in him, you can be sure that there is nothing that belongs to Jesus that does not belong to you. You can be sure that the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation belongs to you. You can be sure that the Holy Spirit belongs to you. You can be sure that Jesus lives right within you. But you can also be sure that everything in you belongs to Jesus as well. I hope you take both the side of it. You can be sure that every sin, every struggle of yours, every single disappointment in your life was in actual fact died for on the cross and nailed into Jesus' hand. God made Jesus to be sin for us, who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God. So Christ appears to them. He rebukes them for their unbelief and inaction. And then he commissions them and gives them the summary of the gospel or the good news that they are supposed to preach. That message, that commission has not changed. It's the same today even for us in the church. If there is disbelief and inaction, Christ still rebukes us. The problem is many of us don't hear it. We are deaf when Christ speaks to us. The commission still stands good. And he still rebukes the church because there are still millions who have not heard the gospel. And as he commissioned the disciples, so has he commissioned us to take this gospel, the good news, to the ends of the world. The message is very simple. It's not complicated. You don't need a BD degree or an MTH to preach that gospel. It's very simple. Mankind is condemned for eternal destruction, but God has made a way. That is the message. That's all you need to preach. And that way is through Jesus Christ. It's a simple gospel. It's a simple message. Don't make it too complicated. Give it to people freely. And don't blame it on the culture or the situation or the circumstances and say, because of that we cannot preach it. Today, there is life threat if you preach the gospel in India. I tell my team, you have only two options. Either to be afraid and scared and give up, or to say, no matter what, I will stand faithful to the call to which God has called us. You have only two options. You can say all kinds of reasons, everything. But there's only two things. Either you remain faithful or you give up. Make a choice. And then thirdly, we see in that passage, they were endowed with power. They were empowered with power. These signs shall follow them that believe. Not that all who believe shall be able to produce these signs, but definitely some of them. Even as many as were employed in propagating the faith and bringing others to it, for signs are intended for them that believe not. The empowerment added much to the glory and the evidence of the gospel, that the preachers not only wrought miracles themselves, but confirmed upon others a power to work miracles. You know, these signs and miracles were given so that it brought glory to his name and not to exalt the preacher. God still does those miracles and wonders. You know, we see that very often in our own work. Recently, we had a Muslim lady who came to our institute. For 14 years, they were married. They didn't have a child. And when she came, when she heard that we pray and God does miracles, she asked our tutors, can you please pray for a baby for me? You know, within a year, she was conceived. She had a baby. In fact, just a few weeks ago, she had the baby. God does miracles. We had another lady for whom the husband had walked away and she was there because they had no other income. She had come, and when she heard that we prayed to Jesus, she asked our staff, can you please pray for me that before I leave this place, my husband should come back to me. One day before her graduation, her husband returns back and apologizes and says sorry, and they were united. Today, both of them are part of the local church. God does miracles where it is needed. That does not mean you can go and demand all the time, I want a miracle. It is for those who don't know Christ, mainly. Of course, he does miracles in our lives too. But don't make it as a demand from God. Wherever they went to preach, they shall do wonders in Christ's name, the same name into which they were baptized, in the virtue of power derived from him and fetched by fire and by prayer. Not for their benefit, nor was it for their glory, but for the others to believe and to be saved. And then in the passage, we read about the ascension, Jesus going up into heaven. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. After the Lord had spoken what he had to say to his disciple, he went up into heaven in a cloud, and he was received into heaven. He had not only an admission, but an abundant entrance into his kingdom there. He was received with loud acclamation of the heavenly host, and he sat at the right hand of God. He sat at the right hand of God, which says the sovereign dignity he is advanced to. If we are going to understand the ascension, we have to understand this. When Jesus leaves his disciples, he's not really leaving his disciples. When Jesus goes away, he's not really going away. Many people say that Jesus went into heaven and then he leaves us with the Holy Spirit. Yes, he does send the Holy Spirit. That does not mean that he himself, Jesus, is somewhere else and he is not with us. Jesus is always there. If you notice, Jesus doesn't say the Holy Spirit will be with you always. He says, I am with you always. You know, some believe in the church that Jesus has gone up into heaven and he is stuck at the right hand of God. Jesus is not stuck in heaven. Yes, he is seated at the right hand of God. But if you understand the right hand of God, the right hand of God can be anywhere and everywhere. And don't think Jesus is up there, only Holy Spirit is here. Jesus is still with us. Jesus is still among us. As God the Father is everywhere, and as his hand, right hand, Jesus is everywhere with us. God is continually looking after the world, and his right hand is everywhere. So Jesus is true man, true God, one person, can also be everywhere, wherever he promises to be. Whatever God does concerning us, gives to us, or accepts from us, it is by his Son. Now he is glorified with the glory he had before the world. And fifthly, and finally, this really encourages me, the work of the disciple. A scared bunch of disciples, a scared bunch of people who didn't want to do anything. Look what they did afterwards. We have here the apostles working diligently for them. They went forth and preached everywhere, far and near. Though the doctrine they preached was spiritual and heavenly, and directly contrary to the spirit and genius of the world, though it met with abundance of opposition and was utterly destitute of all secular support and advantages, yet the preachers of it were neither afraid nor ashamed. They were so industrious in spreading the gospel that within a few years the sound of it went forth into the ends of the earth. We have here God working effectually with them to make their labor successful by confirming the word with signs following, partly by the miracles that were brought upon the bodies of the people. And on the day of the Pentecost, they appeared publicly and preached the gospel in diverse language. And after the death of Stephen and the persecution raised upon that, they went forth from Jerusalem and preached everywhere, not only in Judea and in neighboring countries, but all over the world in the process of time. The Lord was working with them, making their ministry useful for the conviction and the conversion of large multitudes, and for the forming and settling abundance of gospel churches, and for the comfort and edification of the saints, all which was done by the power and grace of Christ, without whom they could not have done anything. That power is still available to us. That signs and wonders still available to us. But are we industrious enough to preach the gospel as the disciples did? It is the same commission that Christ has given to us as well. And it is also the same power and authority that he has bestowed upon us. And the response when we obey his command and preach this gospel would be the same. Some will accept it, some will reject it, some will oppose, and some will mock at us. But the preaching must go on, because there are many who are yet to hear the gospel or the good news. You know, in India today, so many people are losing their lives, physically attacked, legs broken, heads cut off, just because of the preaching of the gospel. Does that mean we keep quiet? We run away from the commission what God has given to us? No, friends. We have to be faithful to the calling and the commission what God has given to us. You know, we may not see immediate results, nor we may see visible impact of our preaching, but that does not mean he is not at work. Our call is to proclaim, and we must go on doing this irrespective of the response. The message of the gospel is simple, yet it is profound and powerful, and we should treat it as such. You know, the great encouragement this morning is, Christ is with us. The Holy Spirit is with us. And like the disciples, we must continue preaching this message, even at times it may be life-threatening, because there is no other way mankind can be saved. I hope you understand this. There is no other way than the gospel by which mankind can be saved. That should put some urgency into our hearts. That should put that we must be industrious about doing this commission which God has given to us. And it will be selfish on our part to keep this message to ourselves. So like the disciples, let us be industrious. Let us be relentless in taking this gospel to the ends of the earth, because we are the ones whom God will hold us accountable for this generation. Don't think the previous generation is accountable for our generation. Nor is the future generation. You and I are going to stand before the judgment seat of our God one day, and we must give account for this generation if we do not preach the gospel. They have no other way to come to know Christ. It's you and I, both through words and our action, must proclaim the good news. And that's my prayer this morning for me and for each of us here in this church, that we will be faithful to the commission that is entrusted to us, and we will preach this gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. May God enable us to do that. Amen.